I'm very fortunate to have two good friends here who are renowned Canadians from apparently different areas of expertise. William Thorsell, for years the editor-in-chief of the Globe and Mail, a writer, the man who built the, or managed the building of the Magnificent Crystal. And Glenn Morley, who is one of Canada's great writers, composers, arrangers, who has been living in the electronic world of music since its inception, has done entire musical scores electronically. And I brought them together because William, though he's renowned in the areas that I described, amongst a small group of friends, is also renowned as a pianist and has a great hobby, has two pianos, three now. And I think by his own admission, completely took the digital or electronic piano for granted, thought it a toy, until his life changed and he's living part of his life in Costa Rica. And Costa Rica is terrific for people, but not so great for pianos. So I dragged him in here and introduced him to the world of Roland digital pianos. So I'll leave the rest up to you, gentlemen.
There you go. Well, you know, the point is he didn't really drive me in. I snuck up to Rob Lowrey at a party last summer at Luminato. I was really embarrassed. I said, you know, I don't even want to raise this with you, not realizing that he had created a whole new Roland studio. And I explained I was in Costa Rica and I spent months there without a piano, and that starts to make me a kind of crazy person.
Yes.
You have to have your keyboard. And I said, do you know anything about electronic keyboards? Well, that's when he told me he had this whole new Roland world. So I came down here, and I was sort of prejudiced against this kind of thing. You know, I'm sort of used to the early generations of these that were the old Hammond organ kind of things, you know, that always ended up in somebody's basement. But when I tried them out and so forth, and then I got a very basic one, but very capable of many, many things, because I want to take it down on the plane with me, you know, down to Costa Rica.
Yeah.
I took it up north to my house in the country for a month or so in advance, and I was just amazed, at the quality of the piano sounds, and you can have slight differences because of the
different
programs. Yeah. But then it opened up this whole other world, you know, of other voices. And as soon as you have a harpsichord, you have to play some harpsichord music. As soon as you have an orchestral sound, you have to, or some ethereal sound, you've got to play, you know, Star Trek kind of music, and all kinds of different other possibilities are kind of opened up, but more than opened up, they call on you to try different kinds of music. But I got the piano down to Costa Rica for 4 months this winter. Of course, it stays in tune. Very important.
Yes, the right? top list.
Absolutely, and
it gets overlooked. Yeah, actually,
it stays in tune. No one down there would be able to take care of a piano, so it works perfectly. I sit on this mountaintop. I practice every day. I explore new things, and I'm just starting all that overdubbing stuff. And I've got the book that I'm reading, and I'm learning Spanish 3 hours a day and learning Roland 3 hours a day. So it's been a good winter.
Maybe you should just use the Spanish manual.
Perhaps that helped.
Kill two birds with one stone.
But you, who have, you've done even something more radical, because I still have a Yamaha grant here in the city and in the country. You turned in, as I understand it, a Bechstein.
Just a Bechstein, but a really interesting Bechstein B, which was, I believe, the last year that they made ivory.
Oh, man.
About 64, 65. Rob could correct us.
Yeah,
on
I think
that,
that's about it.
But the great technicians here did an interesting. When I first came in, I know Rob and I know Brian here, wandered in one day. And Brian looked at me and he said, "Come here." And he pulled me over, and I sat down at this piano, and I said, "This is great. What happened to this piano? Because the whole lid of it was all wrinkled up like a prune."
Aye.
And apparently whoever was the owner, had been one owner before, had put it in a picture window.
Oh.
And put pledge on it religiously.
Oh my God.
So it just.
And then baked it in the sun.
Exactly. So it was a great piano, but it had had its trial. So the shop did a great job on that. And, you know, finally I had the pedigree piano, wonderful, you know, someone had played it. I didn't have to do all that. And as everybody who buys a piano that's new, it's like a new car used to be, you have to, you know, you want someone else to do the heavy lifting if you can on breaking it in. Great. It's got a, all the damp chaser kind of stuff built into it and so forth. And I loved it. But I wasn't playing it. Because every day in the studio, I'm sitting down playing weighted keyboards with these great pianos. And it disturbed me that I wasn't playing it. So I would sit down.
Because you have thoroughbred sort of.
Exactly. And it's a piece of art. As well as being a great instrument, it's a piece of art. And it's something you appreciate. And the same with Elaine, you know, she'd sit down and play and go, isn't this great? And then we wouldn't play.
Yeah.
And it would go on for months and months and months.
Wow.
Finally.
Criminal neglect.
Well, it's, again, I do think it's like owning a thoroughbred horse. You do not expect, you can't treat them just like, you know, barnyard animals. They require a certain amount of attention that be paid to them. And you have to do that. But if you're not playing them, it becomes a cycle. I think what most people jump past right away is how important tuning is, not just because of what you're used to, but what the public is used to. And the show I was just mentioning to you, the one we were doing down in Niagara, mm-hmm. when we were doing the lifts of all the original stuff for 60s and 70s, that stuff is so horribly out of tune, you want to go and crawl the wall. Like, not just a little bit, but quarter tones here and there, and sometimes more than that. It's almost unlistenable now in a certain way because we are so used to hearing things being very closely in tune. And I realized more and more that it wasn't just the activity, but the fact that the sound itself is in tune is a huge part of what gives me, as a player, my sense of inspiration, because the piano in my home is not for me professionally, it's for me personally, so it's the same kind of deal. And that's huge.
Yeah.
Has to start there.
Yeah.
All the electronic instruments are in tune and you can mess about with them, but what's interesting about this instrument is it now actually is an acoustic instrument. It just happens to me, and I know a lot about this stuff. As Rob said, I first started using electronic instruments when we tuned them with the soldering iron.
Right.
So it's not a new thing.
The other thing that I found incredibly helpful, because I'm living in a place with other people around all the time, stuff, and I really started to love this, headphones.
Isn't it great?
Headphones, you know, I can play away and practice away and mess everything up and whatever, and not bother anybody else. But it also gives me the privacy that I can play whenever I want. Because when you're playing and there are other people around, you know, you're always aware that someone's listening, right? It doesn't matter who they are. So suddenly I could play in the middle of the night, as I said last year at the Roland event, you know, when God meets the Glenlivet, you can really get going, you know? And you can do all of these things. And even during the day, you know, for 3 hours, if I happen to just get into the mood and I'm playing, I almost rarely took the earphones off because I just found that world was private and personal, and the sound was terrific.
The sound is
so here I was sort of with these glasses on, you know, and my earphones on, and people would always come looking at and say, oh, it's, you know, it's Stevie Wonder sitting in there, you know. So it was an aspect to the whole thing that was another.
I can completely reinforce that, and again, for both of us who play, like Elaine is a night owl. She's up all night, and she'll be working on something that she's preparing 3 a.m. Who cares? Not a problem. Not
Very
a problem
pleasurable.
At all. It is, and again, for a lot of people, headphones. I don't know these. These are not your grandfather's headphones anymore.
No.
There's any number of things, and they're so inexpensive, and they're so fantastic.
Yeah.
Like years ago, I wouldn't even have considered mixing on headphones. Now I do it all the time.
And you can hear the differences more clearly.
Well, there's just the quality and cost of headphones. The quality has gone up and the cost has gone down, and the variety has also gone up. So you can now mix with headphones and have a reasonably good expectation that it will match on other speakers. Now, you're going to test on all kinds of things anyway when you're mixing once you're finished. So it'll be on speaker 8.
So you're saying that now that you have the V-Grand, you're on that keyboard a lot more than you were on your Vexen?
More so in the first 2 weeks than either one of us have been playing for the last couple of years.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
That's a whole reality in itself. That's probably the most important single fact. I mean, if you're spending so much more time on the keyboard because it's an electronic keyboard.
Stuff got pulled out. Our little party pieces are now sitting there. Oh yeah, we really should practice
them. Isn't that great?
You know, but it's interesting when you're in the profession, of course you're doing that all day long. So you're not doing it, even though the instrument is capable of doing a lot of the stuff that I do in my studio, it's not the tool that I would use for that reason.
Right.
It's more, this is my inspiration. The other thing that I find with this instrument, and there's lots of other electronic instruments out there, but it's the totality of the experience as an acoustic instrument is what is inspirational. Even with the headphones on, it feels like you're playing an acoustic instrument because the keys feel. I specifically mentioned that I had a Bechstein with ivory.
Right.
Right? Which is a big deal.
Yeah.
I like this way better. It just feels better. Right. And it feels like ivory.
So do you compose on this instrument as well?
Haven't had it long enough really to be doing. Usually when I'm composing, I have all of my computer gear and so forth on it. So it's more been if I'm practicing for something.
It would allow you to do some composing.
Oh, absolutely.
Save and try.
Yeah. And it's got all the regular stuff we are more or less accustomed to with electronic. You know, there's a MIDI connection and so forth.
Glenn was pretty sheepish when he finally called me over to see his Bechstein.
Yeah.
When I entered the house, it was like a poor dog that hadn't had a walk in 8 months. He was embarrassed, but it's true. I mean, working in a piano store, you're used to pianos that are in tune all the time, and I never hear a piano that's in tune, so in a way. And the better the piano, it's like a great athlete, the more you expect
it. The more you expect
it. And so the flaws become more noticeable. And
that's it. And in fact, when I had the Bechstein initially, I was in there. Again, as an amateur tuner, I've rebuilt pianos myself when I was a kid. So I have some knowledge of the thing. And I'd be poking away and thinking, maybe you do this, we'll get Keith to come back, and maybe, as you spend more time monkeying about with it, that is a pleasure in itself on a piano, but it's not playing the piano.
Right.
I mean, it's like sailboats, you know. You don't spend your whole time sailing them either.
No.
Part of the fun is tinkering around.
And if you have a problem with this, then Joel comes over and reboots
it. That's right.
Exactly.
Well, reboot is the universal solvent for all things, but... you can tinker, this is the other aspect of it. You can tinker with this piano the way you could tinker if you had that inclination that you would have with a great instrument where, you might be wanting to have it revoiced, and then you have your person come in and say, no, this is what I'm looking at the crossover point. I'm just finding the break to blah, blah, blah.
So when your friends come over to your house and they see a Roland Grand instead of the Bechstein, Do you feel sort of embarrassed at the beginning, saying,
no.
"Oh, I went to the dark side" or something like that?
Most people know me are now saying they would be going, So should I be getting a
There you go.
Yeah.
Early adopter, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm trying not to be on the bleeding edge on stuff the way I used to be, simply because there are so many more worthy and candidates to be there, but usually I'll look at a technology after it's been out a couple of years.